so much.
It's a lot going on.
It's a very dynamic
and growing community that just continues to spread out in new and interesting ways. So I'm happy to be invited. Thank you so much, Ashley and Bobby, Bang Bang, for having me on today again.
Yes, absolutely. This is going to be fun.
Well, great. Where do you guys want to start? I hear you've been talking for a while now. So, what's fascinating you guys? What's come up?
Ashley,
happy to be invited. Thank you so much, Ashley and Bobby. Bang bang for.
Is that?
Oh, we've got a delay, don't we?
Yeah. I think so. This is gonna be fun. Yeah, we've got a delay.
Who do you guys want to start?
Oh, is that coming through your speakers, maybe, Mike?
For a while now. Is that coming through my Google Plus or something?
I think so.
Where is that coming from?
It's not on my end.
Let me see if it's on my end. I don't think it is. No?
I don't think it is on my here. Let me try this.
Well, we've been talking for a couple of hours waiting for.
Here we go.
You got it?
Yeah.
It's online.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
It opened awesome. A new window. I'm sorry about that. It started doing that. I didn't know.
No, you're good. Okay. You're totally good. Okay.
Now I'm noticing here on my side, I don't know if I have, it looks like I may, am I controlling the who's on screen? Like I just pressed Ashley and then, or who has control? I don't know how all that works.
The person who sent the invite has some controls over that.
Is there a way to set it so that the audio is what controls it?
I think so, but I don't know.
I think I have that. I mean, I just see, like, the links and stuff, but I don't see any audio or anything. But that's okay. We can go ahead and start.
Okay.
But we were just chatting for a while now, talking about all the different cosmologies, the similarities and how that they mirror each other in the different cultures and the different maps and how the Norse mythology and the Hindu and the American Indian or Native Americans, you know, all the ancient civilizations pretty much mirrored each other and stuff. And so
having like a central mountain and having subsurface levels of various, they always seem to relate the level of consciousness or the level of spiritual growth with these levels too. Like it seemed to me like it's almost uniformly assigned. There's a type of character or spiritual state that's associated with these realms.
Right.
That are cosmologically linked, often by, you know, underground systems, or, I mean, it's not entirely clear. They just call it the world or the realm or mm-hmm. what we know of as where we inhabit. And, of course, we've dismissed all of these with the advent of the heliocentric model, because now we have the answers. We've bounded and measured the entire thing. It's a spinning ball, and that's that. Except now we're uncovering with flat Earth theory, maybe not. And as we move through or past the point where we've proven it to ourselves that the Earth is flat, now we're getting together and asking the questions, well, what is going on? Well, what were these wisdom traditions trying to teach us?
Exactly. What we're finding out what they have is not actually myth, it's actually fact, and digging up these old maps isn't as easy as it seems either, because a lot of it has either been destroyed or covered up, and or mislabeled I've ran across things in I'm an old book collector. I love old books, and things aren't even labeled as, say, world or earth or whatever. It'll it'll say terra plana or the terrain, you know, of the ancient civilization. So it's sometimes it's kind of hard to even find you know, old information on these people. But
yes,
they definitely weren't, you know, behind us in technology.
No, there appears to be a lot of lost technologies, actually. Ways of working with natural forces, electromagnetics, acoustics, copper, and combinations of those in order to create effects like lighting and, you know, working with plasma. Perhaps
exactly.
The stones might have been cut with plasma. They're laser precise, better than we can do today with modern equipment. 100-ton blocks that we couldn't move into place with modern equipment. We could not build the pyramids.
Right.
Our cranes are not big enough. Obviously, they were moved into place with ease, and these enormous blocks number in the millions around the world that have been placed. So it appears this was a global culture or cultures,
right,
and that we're not the first, and that we are under some type of deception or forgetting or both that is hiding, occluding from us our true history. And I think that's part of what's so exciting.
Absolutely. And, okay, that leads me to a question. The pyramids in Egypt, they're aligned with Orion, you know, the
yes.
Okay. Well,
the
then,
belt. Yeah.
And then if you go to Chaco, New Mexico, that is also a huge star map. And
yes,
it is aligned by Orion and Sirius as well.
Yes, not just for a lark. I mean, they were tracking the precession with these concentric rings at Chaco, and their knowledge was obviously sophisticated and would have had to have taken place over a long period of time.
Right.
In order to be able to establish and track some of these lengthier cycles.
Exactly.
Decades and centuries, actually. So how are they able to do that? Where did their information come from? Was this remnant from a prior culture? My guess is probably yes.
Absolutely.
I don't think they came up with it, originated there. It there in the desert, and we have it here in Colorado as well. There are petroglyphs.
Yes.
Sites that haven't really been investigated or explored that are still out there. Places like Picket Wire Canyon between La Junta and Alamosa, or between La Junta and Trinidad. Picket Wire Canyon has petroglyphs, and it appears they may have been tracking the procession there. The Los Lunas stone in New Mexico, in Los Lunas,
right,
with the Decalogue carved into it in Proto-Phoenician. This is a language that was not translated or decoded until, I think, the mid-20th century. So this find predates that by about 70 years or so.
Right. Yeah.
So it's highly unlikely it could have been a fake. So, you know, people got around. It appears the Phoenicians particularly got around, may have been here in the States. And that there's just a whole lot about our Earth and our Earth science that's being distorted, that's being hidden from us. So flat earthers who are at this for a while now are beyond our outrage, and we want to know, we want answers to these things. So there's a lot of curiosity and a lot of experimentation to be done.
Absolutely.
See what the heck is going on. So
well,
I really, really appreciate that you're doing that too, Ashley.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. That's where my brain is like, science comes easier for me than math, and that's where, like, you're a genius. And I mean, Bobby's got the talent of music, which I wish I had. But like Chaco Canyon, it was preserved for, you know, hundreds of years because of the rancher that bought it and used it for, you know, his cattle for so many years, and then he just sold it like 15 years ago, where of course the government bought it, and they're exploring all of the kivas and giving tours there now at the solstices and things like that. But you're right. I mean, there's so much we don't know. Like William Gilbert in the 1600s, he was a scientist that said the Earth is a giant magnet. And he said that his theories got all shot down because of heliocentrism. So there's some great minds that were being trashed because of this ball.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I always wonder about Tesla too.
Yeah,
he suspected, or if he knew. I mean, he had this one idea. He was going to do an experiment where he built a ring, a floating ring, around the Earth. He said. So, and then I always pictured a planet, you know, like a ball with a ring around it, like we always see the planet Saturn depicted. Uh huh. Illustrations. So I thought, you know, he was going to do something like that. But now I think maybe he was thinking about building something around a flat disk that was elevated to like a charge plate, something reacting.
Like
with
a charge plate, like, because he did build the purple charge plate that he invented.
Yeah, the electrostatic coil. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that's what he was talking about, was he could, you know, actually build one that, I think maybe that's what Wardenclyffe was. I mean, it starts to make sense.
It does. Like what Bobby said earlier about Bach with the granite slabs and stuff, I know that Tesla, you know, he dug down to the granite bedrock because he said granite was super conductive. And he needed, you know, he wanted to use that, the granite. And I know that he poured some kind of minerals around Wardenclyffe, but I don't know. And, you know, there's a mystery as far as hydrogen. I mean, there's metallic hydrogen. I honestly think that our whole weather system, what we've been told as far as the evaporation and all that whole cycle of weather is completely bogus, and we need to completely redo it and experiment with all the different weather anomalies and stuff, which would be fun, but time and, you know, things like that. But Bobby was talking about, what is the guy's name? It's Bach.
The Bach saga, a guy named Eeyore Bach, Finnish guy. Have you heard of this guy, Michael?
No, I'm not familiar with him. He's an electromagnetic theory guy.
Well, no, he was, I guess, the last in a line, a familial line, who had passed on an oral tradition of explaining our origins, and a lot of it lines up with Norse mythology, which is what got us talking about that. And to do with also misplaced history. What he was teaching was that what he had learned from this tradition is that there was an entrance somewhere in Finland to, you could call it hollow earth or an underworld.
Yes. I wonder if it was across the Bifrost.
And that, anyway, what ended up happening was he, in the 90s, got a lot of support and some good funding and actually began an expedition and found these massive slabs of granite that were covering I mean, more these slabs bigger than the stones at Baalbek, the base stones at Baalbek, and so they'd found these massive stones of granite, and started an expedition. What's the word I'm looking for?
Excavation.
Excavation. Thank you.
Yeah.
And they did find a cave entrance. The story behind these slabs of granite was that the Roman Empire, around the time that we would consider 1000 AD or CE, that around that time period, the Roman Empire had those placed there, which is really interesting. And it, but when we think about the potential fabrications of history, you know, history always being
of the victor,
autobiography of a guy named Victor, autobiography. So anyway, just really interesting implications in the Bach saga. And it ended with the Finnish government shutting down the excavation and blocking off the site. And Eeyore Bach, who seemed a real peaceful guy, ended up being stabbed to death in a mysterious circumstance. So. Just a really intriguing thing to look into. There's, you could probably find some about him on YouTube and some videos that he had made before he died on that stuff.
Well, really, what do you guys think about like Andrea Barnes and like Amelia Earhart? Like, do you think that say Barnes or Earhart? Do you think they actually went missing, or do you think that they were killed?
That's interesting. Michael?
A little speculation. Don't know. Andrea Barnes sounds like, too apocryphal, too buried to really know what happened there. So, nope. Can't say with any certainty. Just really looking forward to having an investigation on foot, as is our right. We talked a little bit about the Free Earth Manifesto. Or flat Earth, flat and free Earth, it should be called, manifesto, which involves the first right of exploration. Talked about this with Lori as well, months and months ago, on a hangout. This has to do with our presumed right, our first right, our sovereign right to explore our surroundings.
Oh, and absolutely.
We're not allowed to explore our surroundings. This is something that requires extraordinary evidence to support. Like, there would have to be an amazingly good reason why humanity is not allowed to explore, and it's not been forthcoming. Quite the opposite. So, we rebuke that, and we refute that, and we want free exploration. So I'm working on the manifesto, trying to get that out there. I read some of that off in the last hangout. I don't know if we want to go there again. We can talk about that. We can talk about some sovereignty stuff. We can talk about science, energy, occultism, cosmology, whatever you guys are up for, really.
Awesome. Absolutely. Let's touch on it all. I don't care.
It's too big.
We should
narrow it down.
We can just go commando, huh?
See, yeah, just go commando. No. That's the best way. No. Okay, well, let me pick your brain. What do you think, why do you think Russia wants the Arctic circle? Why do you think they want control of the Arctic?
Well, I think, yeah, that's huge. I think having control of the pole, the magnetic pole, and having, you know, your military there, your foremost there, that is a huge, huge strategic advantage for any nation state to claim that they're, you know, they're the guardians and caretakers currently of this precious special patch of water that just happened to be the magnetic center of things. And now what we're learning slowly, what's coming out, is that there's not as much ice up there as it's actually a lot more navigable than what we've been led to believe.
Right.
And there's a lot of crossings going straight across the polar sea now. And I've seen it passed off as global warming. And the polar seas are melting. And I'm like, wait a minute. My whole life I grew up being told the North Pole was just a frozen, solid wasteland. Man, you die. You can't get anywhere near the North Pole. You've got to be somebody with five snowmobile suits on and all kinds of high-tech expedition gear to even get there. And now, you know, then they're like, I don't know. It's been a while now, like maybe 15 years. It's been... Oh yeah, we would like just cruise across there in the boats, you know, because global warming, and now we got to see who's going to be in charge of these new trade routes. that are between like Svalbard and Canada, mm-hmm. and I'm like, when the fuck did this happen? You know, this is just like, just threw this out there. I was like, I don't know, you know, in my 30s or something, and all of a sudden here's this stuff like, oh yeah, we sail all over the North Pole Sea. I'm like, what? It's not frozen solid anymore?
Exactly.
It's not frozen solid anymore, guys, so, you know, Mandela effect.
Exactly.
Maybe if I go back and look, it'll always have been open water.
Right. But we're told something completely different.
You just got to go in the summer.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, you just got to go at the right time.
I saw some winter pics. That's all. It just looked cool.
Well, okay. So get this. If you take, which I did this the other day, I took a ring magnet and I put it on an old monitor. And then when you take a ring magnet and you stick it on a little, guess what happens in the middle?
Oh, yeah, it'll pull it all over the place.
The flower of life. It makes the flower of life symbol in the middle of the magnet. And I'm like, oh, my gosh, that symbol has been found in every civilization. So it just the first when I did that, I instantly thought of Arctic North. Instantly.
Yeah, so maybe the center of the flower is Arctic North, and if we knew the magnetic pattern, for real, the ley lines,
right,
intelligently, that would give us probably a pretty good idea of at least the scope of how big this bubble is.
Exactly. You know?
And if we're part of a larger complex structure, or if this is it,
right.
Are in a bubble, Where are we if it's a bubble? Yeah, don't know. Don't trust the information that's been coming forward. So we're in kind of this precious time, this in-between space. Those of us who've shattered the illusion of the ball and are looking forward towards answers, this is that that very special, very sacred place called the in-between space that Buddhists are very well familiar with, and people that do you know, deep meditative work are familiar with this boundary place, this place between conditions, which is where we are. You could liken it to sunrise or nightfall or an equinox. There's this precious place where the doors are open and the questions are being asked. And, you know, it's a great time to get together with people who are of like minds and share. Without the trolls and the shenanigans. And
I know, without all the shenanigans.
Ruining the conversation. Yeah, just trying to ruin the conversation
so
it doesn't happen. Because this is what would be happening if we didn't have that, you know, that effort being put forth by certain groups, certain shadowy groups with shadowy interests who really don't want that conversation to happen.
Right.
Really would like to steer the conversation. They seem to know that there's this awakening or this change, this shift in a paradigm coming, but rather than, you know, stopping it, what they'd like to do is kind of insinuate themselves and see if they can direct it a little bit.
Exactly.
That's exactly what it seems like.
Yes.
That's exactly
right. So they're letting the truth come out about flat Earth and about Earth science and about NASA being phony and so on. But what? But what? They want to do it in a slow way. They want to do it in a careful way. And you see a lot of characters who are so eager to put themselves forward as absolute experts. You know, and you see this kind of madness go on.
Right.
With one person after another stepping forth and declaring, it's like this. And you're like, you're the old cult preachers on the streets of Judea, vying for attention like they portrayed in Monty Python's Flying Circus. It's follow the shoe. This kind of stuff. So all that's going on. So it's a very dynamic milieu, and it's a lot of fun. It can be a little sad sometimes. People aren't always very healthy. But what an amazing time. What an adventure.
I know. I was asking Bobby earlier why now? Why are we waking up now? You know?
It's time.
Yeah.
I guess it's an idea's time has come. So it kind of lands in me. How about you, Bobby?
On some of what you were talking about there, we had a little hangout last night, and a problem with the feed, or it may be recoverable. I'm not even sure, but one of the points that I thought was important to drive home, at least, was that and this I mean, for a newcomer to this information, I think there's a lot of flies in the ointment and turds in the punch bowl, you know, that for lack of better dictation. That
somebody wants to ruin the party.
Well, and maybe, and not always intentionally, but I feel like, you know, all of us, I think all of us who have come to this understanding and who are involved in this awakening have largely done so through our own form of, you could call it extremism or radical belief systems or picking them apart and whatever it may be. My point being that when you've got somebody who's got a platform to be an advocate for flat earth awareness, and they're using that platform to say, flat earth Yahweh and weed or anything else. I mean, just to murk the water or muddle it with anything that's not.
Yeah, I hope that is something that the community grows out of and grows through. I do see a lot of that. There's a bit of that infection going on. There's people that are come to this in so many different ways. I'm deeply and genuinely appreciative of the Christian element that's coming forward with their biblical interpretations. I don't think they're always that as familiar with alternative theory and large conspiracies, but they're picking it up quickly and they're applying it, and that's very heartening to see because that's they're awesome. They're taking good information now in the alternative movement, and they're putting those pieces together, and they have passion behind what they're doing. It's not just a sarcastic exercise for them. They're actually bringing their hearts to it. So that's powerful. So I can see how, you know, if somebody was really wanting to, you know, put the squelch on this thing, they'd want to, like, try and mess with that somehow. Make it unappealing. Read it the wrong way.
That's exactly the point I was making, is that, you know, when if someone's given a large enough platform to speak as a representative of flat earth awareness, we don't need to drag in all these other things where they all are a part of that, and people will come to these understandings.
Yeah.
You know,
the name game. It's this group, or it's that guy.
It's divide and conquer.
Right.
It's divide and conquer.
This group is bad. That person's a shill. This religion is evil. That government is the worst. This faction is behind it all. That kind of thing. That name game is going to drop away as more and more truth comes out. It's going to be more irrelevant because people are simply going to be focused on that which is more fun and more important, and it just is the way we're moving forward instead of the ways we're looking backward to look at the wreckage or the, you know.
Right, and because flat Earth is a reality. It's not a conspiracy. It is it's our all of our reality.
Oh, I like that.
You know, we can conspire all day long with theory after theory of who killed JFK or who did 9/11 or whatever. But the flat Earth is reality. It's not a theory. I mean, you can go outside and you can see the horizon is flat. So that's what I think is so cool. This isn't a conspiracy. It is a reality, and we all live.
Oh, I love that. I love the way you put it, that, you know, it's first and foremost a reality. There is, of course, all the trappings of conspiracy that go along with it.
Right.
The reality of Flat Earth is far more interesting than those conspiracies.
Exactly. That's exactly what I mean. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I mean. And you know, and I'm all for everybody searching for the truth in every subject. You know, I would not hinder that by any means. But I'm more science, so I tend to go, well, how does this work? Well, what's this technology inside nature have to tell us? Because I think technology is all written in within nature, from water having memory. You know, that's proven with the snowflakes, Emoto, you know, how he did the test.
Emoto is awesome, yeah.
Yeah, talking to positive, and it made harmonic snowflakes, and then having bad thoughts, and it made, you know, ill harmonic snowflakes and stuff. So
Victor Schauberger,
yeah,
training water in vortexes so that it
Schauberger is awesome.
Uphill. So it flowed uphill. Okay.
Right.
Vortexes at little sluice boxes and at little clever junctions. And
exactly.
2-3 inches of lift out of
exactly.
the water. And you do it again, you do it again, and he made water flow uphill.
Uphill.
Harnessing its own energy, its own natural flowing energy.
Right. And that's how they think that the aquifers near Giza and things like that was his, what he found with the vortexes of the water. I mean, it's amazing.
It's not a popular theory. I'm one of the people that thinks it was a giant irrigation system. It was like a free energy hydraulic ram pump. And it was drawing water in. So the sloping corridor of kings going into the big
exactly.
pyramid. I think
exactly.
it was an enormous flume that had gigantic granite flap gates that were doweled into place, and they would get a lot of weight on them from the water down the sloping corridor. They would open up like this, allow some water to pass until the weight reduced, and then the granite gate would come back down and go boom and close back into place. And so there were a series of these gates that were timed so that they would be resonant, and they would draw in the water, and these flap gates in a series, these granite flap gates that weighed many, many tons, that were enormous proportions, would effectively function as a hydraulic ram pump.
Mm-hmm.
And this thing would just boom and boom and boom and pump water all over the valley for massive irrigation, because water is life.
Right.
And when the British Exploratory Society came along in 1878, they blew it all off with dynamite because they were looking for gold and looking for the king's gold. And so they just blew the shit out of these flap gates, these granite doors, just blew them right out of their dowels, blew the passages open so they could get the gold and destroyed them. But I do think that the whole thing was probably just a, you know, it probably wasn't that hard. It didn't take them that long to build. I'm guessing the whole thing they probably built in a year, year and a half, using acoustic technology and electromagnetic technology to hover, glide, move, maybe with water too, these stones into place, and had themselves this enormous machine. But this is a high-tech structure, not built by the Egyptians. The Egyptians don't claim they built it. They got there later. They put hieroglyphs on it. They said it was a tomb, you know, a burial place.
Right.
I don't believe that. So yeah, as far as it being this high-tech communicating with other civilizations machine of, you know, higher dimensional stuff going on, I don't see the evidence for that. There may be some of that going on. It just looks to me like they were well advanced with an understanding of stoichiometry, fluid mechanics.
Exactly.
And they knew how to make a ram pump. But that's free energy. So we can't talk about the free energy, because as soon as we go, oh, well, if they did that, why don't we do those?
Why don't we do
those?
Exactly.
To put potable water into poor communities where people are dying of cholera and have no access. Can't we just do that? Oh, no, we can't. We can't do any of that anywhere, huh? You know, because that's what we hear. And I will tell you firsthand, there are ram pumps that have been functioning in, like, mining operations for, like, over 100 years.
Exactly.
Don't require any electricity. They just run.
They
okay?
just run. Exactly. Yeah. Perpetually.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The energy scam. The energy scarcity game is a total scam.
It is a scam. It is a total scam.
Yeah, Flat Earth will you know, almost inherently peel the cover off of that as well, because we'll come to understand the organic nature of the electric universe that we occupy.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, look even down to the terracotta pots, the clay pots. Terracotta has electromagnetism in it. And so you put water into
batteries.
Yeah, you put water into these terracotta pots, and water has a memory of its own, and so that combination together, there's a reason why they use certain things. Yes, sure, it came from the earth locally, right there, but then look at the energy just within that life source of water that they were drinking. I mean, there's just so much to learn and so much to gain from our so-called ancestors or whatever, but from that civilization, from those civilizations. That's so fascinating.
Yeah, so where's that? Where's that? We have no need to be pointing at groups and making a mess out of the conversation. There's a lot of things we can be studying.
Exactly.
Yeah, vortex mathematics, Tesla theory, electromagnetic theory, exploration, expedition stuff, civil actions.
Acoustic levitation.
Thank you. Artwork, music, performance.
Right. Plasma.
Web mastering, getting the word out,
finding out, researchers and scientists today still say that they don't fully understand water and they fully don't understand hydrogen because hydrogen has many tones, octaves, and we don't hear about metallic hydrogen today. I mean, you don't hear about these things. There's so many the whole periodic table is another one. I mean, what have you been told? Is it true? Have you tested these chemicals for this is what it does, or it's what does it do under electromagnetic energy? What happens to this element when you add electric voltage to it?
How does your actual physical presence in the proximity of the experiment and your intentions around the experiment affect the electrons and affect
exactly. that
the Schrodinger's cat? Bit.
Yeah, because we know right. that's going on, so that just basically blows Newtonian physics out of the
exactly.
water right here.
Exactly.
Because now if we're looking at it, something happens, and if we're not looking at it, it doesn't happen. And
right.
what's that about, and how do we quantify that, and can
yeah.
we... Should we, or do we just throw up our hands and try and get better aligned in our hearts? Because I don't know if this is true or not. I bring this off Heart Math, Daniel Winter's organization, Heart Math, and they're saying that the heart can produce 10,000 times the electromagnetic charge of the brain. 10,000 times.
I've heard that the heart has stronger.
Big honking seven layered muscle. It's an amazing seven-layered muscle that produces an electromagnetic field, and what they're saying is that they're measuring this stuff with sensors all the time. They do this biofeedback thing. It's recommended for heart patients. People do this as real science and real healing technology.
Yes, absolutely. They do electromagnetic therapy.
Electromagnetic therapy, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and they're saying that the heart can produce 10,000 times the electromagnetic force as the brain. So what this tells me is that these ultra-rational pricks who are all up in their heads and have all the answers and the PhDs and are in this lofty place of learning and tenure can kiss my ass.
Right.
Because they're not walking in a place of wisdom. They're not walking in a place of heart-centeredness where they have any juice. Or passion towards towards humanity's betterment or well-being. So, if they're going to be the gatekeepers to have this conversation, then I'm not interested in talking to them. I'd rather talk to you.
Right.
And Bobby and the other people who can at least demonstrate that they're able to show up for the conversation.
Exactly. Exactly. You know what it reminds me of? It almost reminds me of when the Greek Hellenized the world, basically, or their area at that time. It was their way or no way, and it was more abstract thinking, and they did away with the tangible thinking, and the Greek was very, whatever is beautiful is holy, the Olympics and all that, and where the Hebraic at that time was whatever's holy is beautiful. So it was the complete opposite, and they just kind of tore up everything, and lofty, like you said, it's all in the mind, and it's all...
It became ultra-rational.
Right, yes. Ultra-rational.
Ultra-rational
right.
space became more prominent.
Right.
So this ebbs and flows, and I think in the thick of the Iron Age, you probably have this in its highest expression, this being made of metal, having a mind of metal. Mm-hmm. Like Sauron in Lord of the Rings, finally just makes a deal with the dark and starts producing clone bots, you know, cutting down trees, using nature's abundance to produce his own personal ego-driven army of, you know, whatever power trip he's on. You know,
he
has a mind of metal, and he's all up in his head, and in the glory of his mind, in his inner landscape, what he's doing is wonderful, purifying, you know, just amazing. But he's utterly divorced from children, from women,
humanity.
From biological reproduction. I mean, he's really just gone off into being transhuman, which we could touch on a little bit. The push, the obvious overt and covert push towards transhumanism that's sort of invading our media and being pushed psychologically on the masses right now.
It could definitely
predominant. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They just try to talk us out of our flesh, talk us out of our souls. Like, we're all gonna get downloaded onto a computer. It's gonna be great. We're going to go from being the sacred creations that we are, the divine, powerful creations that we are, to something on a chip, to being binary. And they don't want to do it. The elite don't want to do it. You know, that's why David Rockefeller's on his sixth human heart. You know, they don't want to leave. You know, they're hanging on like a chigger. They're hanging on.
Like a chigger.
They're hanging on. There's no, you know, they're pushing this transhumanism. They're pushing it, but I don't think anybody's really believing it. I think this whole thing's coming from somewhere else. I think it's nasty. I think the truth is going to come out. But no, there's absolutely no way we're going to give up our biological reproduction and the divinity of our soul matrix for a bowl of soup, which is what they're offering. They want us to turn me into a chip. Put me on a chip.
I like that.
And have me report to the AI, the artificial intelligence, you know, that's going to tell me what my life should be like. You know, no. I think this has been done. I think humanity has gone down that road over and over again. I think it's something that we're overcoming here. That's a test of our humanity at this time. I think this is coming out. So you're going to hear a lot of this transhumanism get pushed on people, and they're going to couch it in terms of two words, freedom and choice.
Right.
The people that are pushing this are going to push it as freedom and choice over and over again, and it's not.
It's not. It's another freedom, cage.
You have the freedom to cut off your own nose.
Right, exactly. It's
a lot of that's
your choice. How dare anybody take it away from you? Yeah.
Right.
A lot of that's even tying into, like you were just saying, you know, this isn't the first time it's reminding me of, the Toltec traditions that say we're entering the third sun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all these different traditions, and sure, we can base a lot of it on astrotheology and astrology, and the way people have read the stars throughout the ages. But there is a new age of sorts coming into play, not to be confused with the coined term, the Blavatsky and Theosophist Society stuff. But there's something happening here.
There is something happening.
That's one of the interesting things about the Toltecs, and it's something that I think Mark Knight was the first that dropped this seed in my head, but with speculative ideas and hypotheses about the luminaries and Luna being potentially an old sun. That would fall into line with the Toltec understanding. That was just one thing that popped into my head just then. But and also this has happened before, and we go through who knows how much history we can trust. We've established that. But we can be fairly certain that, that there have been cullings of sorts, and that that there are some entities involved who want to live forever because they're trapped here. Mm-hmm. So they want to extend the amount of time they have here. That's also, I think, why it's important for them to control the structure of how we live. And it seems to be
and a belief.
Test.
Mm-hmm. They want to control our beliefs.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
They need that reverence and they need that praise. And they also need us to be stupid and dependent so that they have some reason to exist.
Exactly.
So the more dumbed down and fluoridated and misinformed
and vaccinated.
Sexually screwed up and everything else we are, the better chance that these AI programs have of being relevant and getting their contracts renewed.
Right.
So they're kind of desperate in that way for us to be not so good.
Look what they're doing now. And even CPS is going into people's homes that don't vaccinate. And these families that have sacrificed to homeschool their children to protect them from being a sheep when they, you know, get older and being indoctrinated, and yet the government is going in and taking these children, so-called, to keep them safe from these families. But what are they doing? They're just making them sheep. They're stealing children to keep them asleep because these families that know and are awake, that don't want to vaccinate, that don't eat GMOs, that don't want to send their kids to a Newtonian-based schools, the government is stealing them.
I want to say that the government, this might be going on. If it's going on, it's pretty isolated. I haven't ever actually seen a verifiable case of CPS taking away children and forcing vaccination and doing forced injections. What I do see are a lot of stories that claim this. And I think there's a reason that it's claimed. I think it's a scare tactic. I think it's so that if it comes up, people will be less inclined to resist out of fear. But my experience was always that if you say no, they can't do anything. And that was the case with myself and with my children. And they were taught if anyone tries to stick a needle in you, you kick them in the shin hard and scream.
Right.
And I always just demanded my waiver, and if they didn't know what one was, I would tell them I'd be happy to provide them with one, and that was that. And they threatened to keep me out of schools and things like that, and I could usually resolve the issue in about 5 minutes.
Yeah. Well, I know.
You're not familiar with it. They haven't heard it before, but I think they do want us to believe that that's really not
well,
the case.
Well, I do know a friend that is in Flat Earth, and I don't want to say names or anything, and they are being hassled by CPS right now. Exactly. And this family does not vaccinate, staunchly against it, and this family also homeschools. And so I do know of someone personally that this is happening to. Now, that issue of CPS coming and stealing families, you know, children, I think that is something that needs activism because there was another child taken from CPS that was killed in CPS. Get off on the whole child thing, CPS thing, but yes, they want to keep us asleep and sheep and they don't want us to
coercion.
Wake up.
I think the point is there's coercion going on. But yeah,
a lot
that would
of
be
fear porn.
A flat earth civil action. Where you know somebody we might be able to support people who are having special needs in that area. I don't see a lot of that coming up. Mostly, it's been an amazing self-selected group of very egalitarian people, and then there are people that are protecting the balance and the beauty of the interactions. Doing their best to kind of enforce an ethic. You know, and some groups I know won't do the discussion of religion.
Right.
Other groups are like, well, let's discuss religion respectfully. And there seems to be a way around all the problems that are coming up as far as people getting along or not getting along. There seems to be answers to all these things. So I do expect the community to just keep growing. And as that happens, issues like, CPS, they're going to get blown away. When there's 50,000 families teaching their kids about flat earth, or 500,000 families you know, they're just not going to have the personnel to handle that kind of a caseload or deal with it anymore. They're going to have to, you know, back off.
Right. Yeah,
they're a little overstrong right now, it appears. Little panicky about losing their power right now is what it looks like.
Oh, but yeah, absolutely. I see the powers that be in a frenzy right now.
In a panic. Yeah. They can't start a war. They haven't been able to start a war. They haven't been able to jack the price of oil back up again.
Right.
Since they pulled out of it. And my inside information is that Anonymous had a lot to do with that. And I know a lot of people think Anonymous is a government psyop and that it's not really real. And I want to tell you guys that there are people in it that are good people in Anonymous.
There's grassroots people in it.
There are grassroots people in it. Of course the government's trying to piggyback onto it. Of course they're trying to psyop it and spin it.
As with any good...
As with every group.
As with Flat Earth. That's the way it is. But don't just dismiss everything Anonymous is doing. But please do verify for yourself. See if it resonates with your heart. See if it's good for mankind. Is it good for you? Does it resonate well? You know, is it about tolerance? Is it about connection? Is it about acceptance? Is it about motherhood? Would your grandmother like it? I mean, it's a short list of questions, folks. It's not that complicated. And if it gets into Middle East politics and having a strong show of force with armaments to combat the ideology of so-and-so, it's probably bullshit.
Right. I agree. 100%.
Thank you for letting me get that off my chest.
I like that.
I love you guys.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And that's so true, too. It is so true what you just said.
Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. So I think God made us just right. I think we have the intelligence innate to our organic structure. I think
Absolutely.
Being aware of flat Earth connects us with that better.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It connects us up better because we're still in stationary, for one thing. So there's nothing to prevent us from simply reaching out with our feelers into the world around us. And suddenly we're getting input and we're getting connections that we didn't feel before.
Exactly.
That feel good. Because
we're
not imperiled. Yeah, we're not imperiled. We're not spinning perilously through the deadly space void, 67,000 miles per hour, and wobbling and multiple vectors and, you know, lava squirting out and floods and asteroids about to strike and God only knows what else we're hurtling into in the void.
Climate change chaos.
Or maybe it's just the way God made it and we're fine. And,
we're
about to learn a whole lot more, but the people that have foisted this whole big blue marble scam on us have to come clean. I was really hoping when the Pope showed up, day before yesterday, that he would have something relevant to say, something earth-shattering. Yeah, come on.
It really seemed like it turned out to be a distraction for some other things that were going on.
Maybe,
You know, and they pump. They got all of us. You know, those of us that try to be mindful of the conspiracies that are afoot and the subterfuge abounding. I think it was a bit of a red herring. All the predictive programming they threw into it, as unoriginal and authentic as it was, it was still.
Maybe they did something really cool, like underground, and we'll find out about it when it breaks through the surface and kills us all.
Exactly. It did seem like a big red herring, though.
I was waiting for the ice giants
worry about it
to
too
wake
much.
Up.
I didn't worry about it too much. Like, oh, the Pope, though, he's going to be in Washington, and there's going to be this funny shadow over the Washington Monument. It's going to be all this occult symbolism and all this stuff. And, you know, I just couldn't get all whipped up about it. I couldn't give it any juice. I think I was just, like, joking around with Bobby and making funny memes and stuff instead. I was just like, you know.
Right.
Sorry.
You've been having a good time with that, too, yeah.
Sorry, Pope. I'm busy making memes with Bobby.
Hey, that's better than listening to the Pope, though.
We had fun, didn't we, though? We had fun with the memes. We got some good ideas for some stuff coming up. It's going to be funny.
Definitely.
What we need. We need to have fun, you know?
You want to lay some Christopher Flatkin on us, Bobby,
is it the right time? Or should
give us a preview of Christopher Flatkin?
Oh, I cannot wait.
This is Celebrity Flat Earth Interviews, and we've just met Christopher Flatkin, long time, very, very well-known Flat Earth activist, Christopher Flatkin. He's going to tell us how this Flat Earth experience has been for him.
Awesome.
Go ahead, Christopher.
Well, the horizon, it's so horizontal. The first thing I noticed...
It's horizontal.
To me, might matter to you. Doesn't matter. I noticed that sea level. Sea level is level.
Yeah.
So.
So what are you saying about the horizon and the sea level are level? Is that basically what you're telling us, Christopher?
You know, Michael.
Yes.
Look at it like this. It's called horizontal.
Horizontal.
Did not get you.
Yeah.
That is okay. Awesome.
All right. So yeah, we'll complete that interview later.
Work to be done.
So are y'all gonna start doing these?
Yes.
That is awesome. That is awesome. We need some humor. That is perfect. Because that'll totally help, you know, just talking to people, like, break the ice sometimes and stop the, you know, I don't know, monotony of, well, my mind is always going with, like, let me figure out this hydrogen chemical bond. So that's going to be fun. I can't wait.
Yeah. So, Ashley, since you know about science, how do rockets work in space?
You know... Always wondered about the vacuum thing and the propulsion. Never figured out how they did that. There must be like this green screen thing that they use behind all that shit.
Are they pushing off of the green screen to move in space? What are they pushing off of?
Exactly.
The rocket exhaust. Now, I heard they're working on a high-tech, fancy, exotic, ion-biasing, electro... technology that will like generate a density platform within the exhaust gases to create something to push off of, and they're just talking about it now. It's like real science fiction stuff that NASA's talking about. But as far as I know, there's nothing like that in space. There's just supposedly got these little clever thruster rockets that just, you know.
I think everything they do is sci-fi.
They go 17,000 miles an hour, and the Soyuz can dock up with the ISS.
Exactly.
How can it
precisely hit, you know, how can it precisely dock up to the ISS while it's going?
It looks really fake, and not one of them can turn and just take some video of the Earth down
there. Right?
When they do, we just tear it up because they get the size wrong and they don't do it right. And it's like, God, you guys are like amateurs. And, of course, they lose all their old stuff. They lose it all, 700 boxes of it.
Right.
They just lost it. You know, like, quick, like Hillary lost her emails. They just lost it all.
They're just gone.
If we were to get a load of that with our new software and our stuff.
Right. Well,
and you would think with their... With the trillions of tax dollars that they've siphoned from us in the name of space exploration,
right.
They could at least hire a decent...
Something like a cool trillion. Yeah, something like a cool trillion. I mean, they could have sent a whole lot of kids through actual college to learn actual things instead of, you know, fooling everybody with this nonsense. So, yeah, what's that? Hey, what about the ethical ramifications of that kind of behavior? Now that we've known, they've kind of gone after this whole hog for, like, I don't know, a while now. What should we do with them?
Oh, man. You know...
FEMA camps?
Right, yes.
Put them in their own FEMA camps, I think is like the number one answer. Yeah, put them in their own FEMA camps.
Put them on...
Re-education. Re-education is in order.
Let them use the sets in there until they see curvature. Yeah,
right.
I don't know. I don't know what we do with them. I'm trying to figure it out. Like, what are people going to want to tear them limb from limb, of course. And then there's going to be all the arguing over, well, we had to, or we had to go along with it, or you don't understand, or it was for your own good. I mean, we're going to hear all these arguments about it's coming. So I'm looking forward to that. That's going to be a while in the future, but I'm looking forward to that conversation. I guess they call it, back in the World War II, after World War II, they called it the Dachau moment. Like, everybody has to have their Dachau moment, where the soldiers were marched past the guards, so the guards were forced by the Allied troops to see the inhumanity they had inflicted.
Right.
Wanted to see them. It was like, it was the first thing Patton said was, document this, film this, because the first thing they're going to want to do is lie about this. They're immediately start lying about this immediately. As soon as we're out of here, you know, it's going to start. So.
Oh yeah, well, and look at the history books. You know, in our kids' schools, they manipulate those like crazy. And just think about like all the just earth science and physics alone. I mean, when my daughter started school this year, she's a freshman in high school. The very first thing her assignment was notes taken off the overhead or whatever they use now. Smart boards, and it was the scientific method, and I about died laughing because I was like, "Oh, you're kidding! The scientific method? They don't even use that. They don't."
It's bait.
They don't even know what it is.
They don't even do anything. I know. And then the next week she brought home, because she's in physics / kind of earth science stuff. I took pictures of it on my cell phone, and it said the Earth's axis spin and gravitation and all this stuff, and I was like, oh my gosh, are you kidding? And she's awake to the flat Earth, so we both had a laugh about that.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And so right now, her physics teacher, he's like one of those that wears the bow tie, and he thinks he's, you know, he's a physics teacher. So. Nope. Right, and so her and I are thinking of like that one perfect question that she can raise her hand, because she's real outspoken, and that one perfect question that she can say, see, I have a question, and we want to like totally stump him with like a flat earth question, you know, like make him think. So, anyway.
Oh, you're good bad. Ones. You're bad.
Good no. ones. I've heard instances of taking like to a mathematician or a math professor and without letting them know you're about to get into anything flat earth related, you would throw them an equation having to do with curvature, right, and say, so if, I don't know, just, I'm not so good with numbers. I don't know why the, I'll carry on. I almost went somewhere I didn't want to go. I was once someplace, I wasn't prepared to go.
Don't worry about it.
To reel it back in.
Yeah, who cares?
But, you know, like, provide an equation.
Yeah.
And say, so, okay, so if you're at this distance from this
I think we say, Mommy took me to Bonneville Flats, and I can see mountaintops 47 miles away. How come they're not 2,000 feet below the horizon?
Exactly. Yeah.
But
exactly.
Just with a simple mathematical equation that would say,
yeah,
okay,
here,
so
I did the math,
correct,
I did
right?
the math for a ball, and it says this should be 2,000 feet below the horizon.
Yeah.
Yeah, explain that.
And let it blow their own minds without you ever telling them.
Let them pull out the atmospheric refraction and the mirage and all that stuff.
I love
that when they do that, because you just can't defend it, and they just squirm and they get uncomfortable because it's the same every single day. Every single day I go out there and look, that same mountaintop's gonna be in that same place, and it ain't gonna move.
Shut them down. That's when the
I'm seeing the same mirage every day. The same mirage.
The same mirage every single day.
Every time I look, but as soon as I look away. Oh, no, it's back safely below the horizon. Don't you worry. Oh, but if you spin around, poof, atmospheric refraction, there it is. I mean, if you're like two different people, we should go out and do this together. And you're like, the three of us look at you. You spin around. Is it still there?
Is it Yeah, that's awesome.
Every day. So, yeah, you're trying to prove the curvature to ball heads every day. And, oh, you can't see stuff. And, oh, yes, you can. And, oh, then it's a mirage. I mean, every day. Flat earthers, after a while, we see things 70, 80 miles away, mountaintops, you know, as I do here in Colorado. I see things at long distances all the time. And I know and I trust that my earth realm is flat and stationary, and it's very comforting.
Right.
So it just it sounds strange to me when people tell me, oh no, those things are actually that you're seeing pictures of are actually below the horizon and out of sight, and it's only through the magic of optical illusions that you're able to see them.
Do you see what they're trying to do, though, by just the mirage? It's magic. I mean,
It's suggestion.
It's that power of suggestion of that magical magic, basically. I mean, telling you that you're not seeing what your eyes actually
right in front of your eyes.
Right, yeah. Right. Like, I mean, like I'm looking at the curtains right now, and them telling me no, they're not real. But I can see them, and I can tangibly look at you in the mountains. Nope, that's not real. That's a mirage. I mean, that's crazy magic to me. I mean, you know?
No, I know.
And the sad thing is people would rather believe that than, you know, like all these people defending the ball, the spinning ball. They would rather believe that than to sit back and I've even told somebody, you know, I've had my ego bruised when I found out we weren't a spinning ball. So just sit back for a second, use some logic. Yes, you're going to think, how did I get duped for 40-some years? It happens to all of us. But just think it logically, you know, and then let it sink in. But they're so violently ready to defend that spinning ball.
That's why I started my new series called Understanding Globehead Emotions.
I love it.
Top notch.
So that we can empathically connect with ballheads and globers who are struggling with flat earth truth and realizing that they don't have any ground to stand on, that they're coming to terms with the fact that the system, the state has divorced them from the very land on which they stand.
Right.
So thoroughly twisted their noodles that they no longer know the shape upon which they allegedly stand, and they're talking to flat earthers who are oftentimes being a little snotty, I'll admit it. So yeah. I wanted to come out with a series of Understanding Globehead Emotions so that we can get in touch with our empathy and help globeheads sort through these difficult transitions.
I love it.
It's a psychoanalytical approach.
Join us at our table.
A little therapy. Provision.
A little therapy, yes. And so to create a safe environment where you know they can feel like they're being seen,
even as
they twitch and struggle with this information.
They twitch. That's awesome. But you know, like I've even told someone before, several of the Globe people. There's an amazing, overwhelming connection that you have when that light bulb, that switch, that gear that falls into that place, and it happens for the first time, and it's like the key lock just and it's like you feel so connected to this divine creator all of a sudden. I do.
I did, and it was wonderful, and I didn't expect that, quite frankly. And I've just been treasuring that and appreciating that ever since. I'm so glad you bring it up, Ash. I don't hear it mentioned too often, but I want to say we're having more fun. We're the camp that's enjoying ourselves and getting to experience the real realm, and we're not going back for any reason.
No. I wouldn't go back to that crazy
chaos. And we're really nice. We're really nice.
Yes.
And there's plenty of room for us at our table. And if you come here and you're respectful and you don't, like, throw food at us, we'll feed you.
Yes. And yes.
We'll share with you.
Absolutely. That's what is so amazing is to find the ones that actually just want to talk, you know, and not call me an idiot. Not tell me not to reproduce. I mean, I've had it all. And I'm like, thanks. Can we just talk? I mean, they instantly think that we're idiots, but we're nice. We're nice.
There's a lot of, there seems to be a lot of failure to recognize or realize that that we too were completely sold on the ball.
We were all ballers. You know,
this has been a harsh awakening for us, some of us more than others, but we're going through the same thing, or we've gone through that. Like it's like you know, with your plan there, Michael, it's kind of like a rehabilitation
Oh yeah,
yeah. Rehab.
Understanding globe-headed motions. Yeah, yeah. It's actually a great way to vent. But what came up, it was me and Simon Ramos, and we were just battling trolls one day, and we just started throwing out these ones with kids crying. And we kind of both realized, I think at the same time, that these ballers are defending something they learned in school that's kind of artificial and not really something their heart's in and something they're not really passionate about. So it's almost like this fake whining, fake crying thing.
They just want somebody to crack
it up. It started cracking me up, so I started looking for these, you know, memes, making memes with kids that are kind of pulling this, like,
oh,
you know, thing.
But I love the Kim Jong, the North Korean kids.
Required to mourn at the funeral. These little Asian girls are all like, I put, make it be a ball again, make it be a ball again. It's that kind of fake crying. Yeah,
there's a lot of emotional attachment for some reason that, it's almost like the ball is almost like taking someone's American pie away from July 4th. I mean, it's like you're stripping them of something that's been with them forever. And I'm like, it's a ball. What does it matter?
It's not even, like they're making a bigger deal out of it than they're really feeling. There's something about it that's not quite honest, you know?
Right.
Cool. They learned it later. They didn't, you know, they're not that attached to it. It's obvious. It's noticeable. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I want to point that out. So I love doing stuff like that with memes. It's really fun.
That is hilarious.
That is fun.
I don't know how much more of those I'll do, but I've got a half a dozen of them, and they just, over the last couple of days, just really funny.
That is hilarious. That is so
funny. Over the fall.
When are y'all going to do the comedy series?
We're working on it. We're just like throwing back and forth lines and assembling like some a rough script right now. And then
we're playing with some ideas.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
Some graphics and some skit stuff, I think.
That is really cool. That is awesome. I love it.
Yeah, I'm excited. I woke up this morning with just light bulbs. It was I think I sent you a message, Michael, but I had this really, really keen idea this morning. Just as soon as I woke up, it was like, bam! Like, it's gonna be a good thing, man.
Yeah, we got like a little intro, and
that's awesome.
I don't want to spill too much.
Absolutely.
We're just working
together.
What do you think about countries like North Korea that aren't allowed to watch TV and internet? I mean, do you think they're pushing? They're leaking out this, or no, not at all?
No.
Never. No, I think they're completely and utterly a CIA-controlled government, a shadow government operation since the 50s. I don't think there's anything free.
They're just like a brainwashed army of people.
Well, look, I'm sure the country's just full of beautiful, generous...
Oh, yeah, I'm not saying they're not beautiful people.
But the leadership, the government itself, no, I think they're seriously into cloning and droning and have been hand-in-hand with our shadow government since the 50s. That's what I think.
Yeah.
I don't think they've been any kind of free agent nation-state for my lifetime, and I'm in my 50s, so...
Well, do you think they're leaking out any of the?
I think they like. No.
No.
No. I think if that stuff's going to come out, it's going to come out in the West by the people who've been involved in it, that really are sick of it and ready to jump ship, and are figuring out that they've been lied to, that they're actually not going to get this false immortality, this godlike status that they thought they were going to get. They were being sold a bill of goods, I believe, this life extension kind of package, the gold package, so to speak.
Right.
I think they've just figured out that it was all a crock of shit, and that they were just another cog in the machine, maybe just one that's a little closer to the center of the overall machine, but nonetheless, no more special than anyone else, and on the menu as well, you might say. So I think that we're seeing an end to a lot of these ancient programs. I think they're expiring. I think we are collectively waking up. I think our consciousness is emerging. You've been hinting at it. There are things we're able to have conversations about now that would have been unheard of 20 years ago, particularly for a guy like me who believes in alternative stuff. It's so much nicer nowadays to be able to chat with people, and not just be dismissed. So,
What do you think about Russia? Do you think that, I mean, are they, is their internet as controlled as, say, North Korea?
No, but almost. But Russia's got some great things. Russia's reminds me a lot of America, maybe 1950s America. But a lot of rah-rah, a lot of political control.
Do you think the flat earth has moved to Russia at all?
Vladimir Putin is popular, I mean, it's kind of a controlled country, but they have a lot of really, really cool people that are way into holistic stuff and spiritual stuff and shamanic stuff and nature stuff.
And dancing and
healing and culture and, beautiful people everywhere on this planet, and Russia too. But as far, again, the corridors of power at the top, these guys have been incestuous for centuries. They're intermarried. They're on the same page. The squabbles that play out in these feudally in these small republics are very real. But at the top, they all get along.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Even with these, I guess, completely third world or as we call them.
They've been mostly co-op.
Meaning like non-NATO or United Nations affiliated. I think maybe. Or is it that they don't see them as having the power to spread certain awarenesses anyway, so they're no threat?
They're not really a threat. There's always degrees of influence and infiltration with this. It's not that any group or any people or any nation state is evil or bad or behind it all. It's more like an infection, like a cold, like the flu, And flat Earth is like a bacteriophage. It's like flat Earth truth is like a bacteriophage that's just gonna go through and just like eat viral cells and just like turn them into mulch.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it has been.
It has been. There's people from so many different countries that have woken up to this organically. Not by word of mouth or not by Facebook or whatever. Or a friend or anything. I mean, they started searching on their own, and I got into it through etymology, through the word Eretz. So, and it was happenstance. I had not seen anybody anywhere put anything, and it's just amazing how so many different countries, there's so many different people that have, woken up. And I love hearing their stories of, like, what was it for them?
Mm-hmm.
Like what triggered that light bulb? What triggered that awakening within their heart? And, because it is a hard thing, too, when you can lay down the ego and lay down the pride of maybe I've been taught wrong about this ball, and then open your eyes with newly and look at the flat earth, evidence that's out there and look at the horizon brand new. So I like to hear what was it that triggered their heart to, lay down that ego and listen or, search and find. Yeah.
And on some level, too, it seems like a collective, what do you call it? Critical mass, 100 monkey type. I mean, you sense it happening around
us. Yeah.
You can feel it.
You can feel it.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really awesome.
And a lot of people say that too. It's like a huge spiritual awakening that's happening as, like you said, a collective mass, and you can almost feel it in the ether. Something
like the smell of cookies.
Right.
Like the smell of chocolate chip cookies wafting through the house. People are smelling it. And that's just not something that's corruptible or stoppable. It's an idea whose time has come. So when we're talking about flat Earth going viral, I think we're all sensing that, and we can see that that's happening. Plus, just the fact that, you know, we don't lose any arguments when people come into these forums and into these groups. They get their butts kicked.
Yeah, they do.
Trying to defend the ball. It doesn't go so well for them.
Right. And that's true. And, you know, it speaking of the cookies and stuff, I think of, you know, like, I live in Oklahoma, so we get Tornado Alley, and it constantly rain, and you can smell that it's fixing to rain in the air. Like, you can feel the energy outside, and, like, if you have the window open, you're like, it's fixing to rain. You can smell the difference.
It's an ozone.
Yeah, like, yeah, it's coming. That's what it feels like with the Flat Earth Awakening. It's coming. It's happening. We smell it in the ether. You know, we know something's going on supernaturally, waking up everybody. And it's awesome. It's awesome.
What an unusual conversation, and how delightful to articulate some of these esoteric aspects of Flat Earth theory in a way that's so easy and casual. You guys are just really amazing to speak with.
Well,
likewise,
so Michael.
Yeah. Eloquent analogies and good stuff, fun ideas. That's a big thing too that you mentioned. I remember. You know, just keep it fun, man.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
And people get so butthurt. I'm sorry. I know it's your precious bubble, but
I know
it's just not real. It's just not. It's like when you got to tell your kid that Santa Claus doesn't exist.
Right.
We lied. We're sorry. We lied. That needs to happen to us. It's like we're a species with separation anxiety. You know,
I kind of think they bought it. For the most part, they all thought it was a ball, you know, right up until, like, recently, like, maybe the late 30s, and they got rocket technology or something, and I don't know, and they're like, oh, crap. And then it was like they had to make a decision, and this is right when television comes out, and it's like, after hundreds of years of academia, it's like Math Boylan was saying, Math Powerland was saying, would you tell?
Would you be able to? Right.
You'd all lose tenure. You'd have a revolution. It would destroy economies. Power structures would be inverted. Things would just be chaos.
The schools would be, right.
People might set fire to shit. Would you tell?
Right. Yeah.
So is that where we're at? Is that where we're at? There's just fuckers just are too chicken shit to tell?
Right.
That's it? You just don't have any balls?
Exactly. Exactly. And then, you know what? That could be it, because they have stolen so much money from the public.
Yeah, they don't want to stop. And it's like, well, we got this good thing going. Can't we just crank this handle a couple more times before we, you know, shut it down and say, sorry, folks, we, you know.
Yeah.
And we didn't know how to tell you, so we just kind of made some shit up and got drunk.
Yeah, exactly. And those rockets, those you know, spaceships, they're actually just tinfoil, and it's just a can.
Yeah, we don't know what we're doing. Propulsion in space. We don't even know what the fuck that would look like.
Yeah, exactly. And we've just, you know, we've got a house in Florida and one in California.
We built a tiny little car and we drove it around and threw some dust in the air and shit.
We were talking earlier, before we got a hold of you, Michael, Ashley and Tom and I, while we were waiting for Zanny, about the footage that we get that's allegedly from ISIS, the ISS.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, so, and I saw this really interesting video this morning that put it in a new light, and it was refreshing, too. But it seems like, okay, we've seen harnesses and tethers, right? We've seen... We've also seen... Harness. That's not always happening, though.
Bubbles.
We've also seen the pool films, mm-hmm. They're shooting underwater.
And bubbles coming up. And,
right. And then, well, this guy's hypothesis is that, similar to cymatics, stop me if I've done this during this aired hangout, because I know I talked with Ashley about it for a moment. But that was before, right, Ash?
Yeah. About acoustic levitation.
Yes. So, like, acoustic levitation, like you were talking, you know, like Leeds Galman, you know, and Newcastle, and things like that.
Yes. So, spinning copper and magnets.
It would stand to reason that some of it is maybe done in a big
in the studio.
Hangar, a big facility where maybe, just maybe, the astronauts don't even realize that they're not in space.
Could be. I mean,
you've got a
perfect way to pull it off. And
you've got to compartmentalize.
I know you're talking about Tiger Dan. I know you're talking about Tiger Dan. I happened to see that one.
That's what it was.
That YouTube video, Tiger Dan. Thank you. That was awesome. Awesome.
He's awesome. He's got a great channel. I love him.
Funny. He really cracks me up. And he's got this theory that they actually may have a little levitation chamber right here on Earth. They're maybe not going anywhere. They're just driving
to
the building next door, and the astronauts are in their little pressurized chamber, and they're getting their feed book, you know, and they think they're roaring through space for all we know.
Right.
And then they just put them in this little sequestered quantum environment where all their sensory input is simulated, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
And they know they don't know from nothing. They think that they
Right, and that's what Bobby was saying is that he said humans are not good at keeping secrets. So these astronauts may not even know that they're not even really leaving planet Earth.
Maybe they're whizzing around the whole planet every 90 minutes. 17,600 miles per hour. Zoom. Light.
We could even bring up like Basiago, you know. Space elevator.
Yeah, well, Andy's got some common sense, and he's an accomplished attorney in the world, and he makes his way just fine, and he's not, you know, begging anybody for anything. Andy's a solid, solid citizen and a good man.
Oh, yeah, I'm not saying anything bad about him.
He's not working any con, and he's also, you know, he's saying flat Earth might be real.
That's what I mean. Yeah,
really
he's
compelling.
Saying, but maybe he wasn't. You know,
yes. He's saying he might have been in a sequestered quantum environment.
Right. That's what I was. Yeah. That's
to clear
what
it up
saying.
For anybody who's listening, he was a child participant in black op programs. Project Pegasus. They were doing jump gate technology. They were using children because they could handle the warpage, the time stream warpage, a little better than adults could, I think. And they were using them and getting their impressions. They were picking intelligent kids. And I think they were also doing some selective mind wiping, you know, like neuralizing, like Men in Black, kind of like poof, you don't remember thing with these kids that were picked because they had high IQs and or their families were in, relatives and such were in these black op programs. So Andy and William Brett Stillings and Bernard Lewis and a few other people did the Mars experiences. Courtney Brown is another one who's still out there.
Courtney Brown, right?
Yeah, so they've all talked about it at varying levels. Courtney denies involvement.
Even that Barry Soros was...
They allege that Barack Obama, Barry Satoru, was also in these programs. Yes. And knew he would be president, even at that age, even like as a 10-year-old. In the early 70s.
Andy seems genuine, yeah, and he does, he's doing fine enough that he doesn't need to come out with some outlandish stories for attention, you know, nothing.
No, Andy's delivered many, many hours of testimony over a long period of time. He's dynamically blogged his experiences on Facebook for years, and his story remains utterly consistent, and I appreciate his voice, so... You know, we can't know. We can't know, Andy, you know, but, yeah, I love you, man. So lots of good people out there, and I think Flat Earth also lets people open up a little bit where they can start questioning other things. Like, if they're lying about that, if you can, like Daryl says, on right there on the Flat versus Sphere board, if you can lie, if you can question the Earth, you can question anything.
Exactly. Exactly. I agree. Mm-hmm. You can question anything. And you should. I think everybody should test everything, even their beliefs. Like, and I was telling Bobby earlier in 2009, you know, I was raised under a certain faith, and I just sat down with some coffee, and I listed all the what I would call doctrines or whatever what I was taught, and I just started cracking them. You know, like, is this truth or is this not, or you know, whatever. And then. Started digging into like the Council of Nicaea and all that stuff, and like, where's the lies? Where's the truth? How did we get this set book with this many? Anyway, not to get off on that, but test everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's an eye opener. Council of Nicaea.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, yeah, and then you see that you see, well,
So if we were to get into that, I mean, it's...
Yeah, go ahead.
Every, you know, you see that just about every denomination of quote-unquote Christianity has been... It was something that was monopolized on and twisted and contorted to begin with to trick people. So every denomination henceforth is fruit of a bad tree. And these are the same behind the, you know, the conquests and
the Inquisition.
Inquisition, and you know, as far as pillaging and doing their best to completely eradicate any records from places like you know, South America, Central America, you know, just to erase these people's histories and cultures.
Well, look at the Alexandria Library that was burned.
Allegedly.
Yeah.
Allegedly.
Yeah, that's where they took all the, you know, the old accounting stuff, all that stuff. Like, well, we don't need all that crap because we stole all the gold. And we'll just tell them we burned all the books, but we'll keep all the good ones.
Right?
Yeah, come on now, come on.
You know, it's brought me to
a we burned it all because we're purists and we didn't want to get heathen knowledge in there. We burned it all.
It's really brought me to a place where I really appreciate the words of Robert Anton Wilson, who said, he said, I don't believe anything, but I have many suspicions.
Yeah.
I guess it's a good place to start, at least.
Yeah, that's a good
place. I appreciate you guys so much for not coming at me with, you know, truth with a capital T. I just find that kind of childish, and it's just nice not to have that going on. So thanks, you know, again.
Likewise.
Much appreciated for the lack of fundamentalism at play, you know, while still being able to entertain ideas that are deeply spiritual, you know.
Right.
I think you can do that, you know. I don't think Newton was an atheist. I don't think Darwin was an atheist. I don't think Wernher von Braun was an atheist. And yet they were all involved in the craziest things. Victor Schauberger was not an atheist. They were enraptured by the miraculous. Even Einstein, you know, even Einstein.
Right.
Sorry. Of course, you know, he was spiritual guy as well. So this taunting people for their religious beliefs. Taunting people for their religious beliefs is so 2014.
Right, right. That's yeah. It is.
Yeah.
And trying to separate it, make it taboo to even talk about. I mean, because
right.
Ancients incorporated spirituality with everyday living. We keep it under our roof. We don't. You know what I mean? Like. For the most part, we don't broadcast it with everything we talk about, which I think that ancient civilizations did.
They did. It was the god language, you know, with the language itself, each letter had a name that was an attribute of God.
Right.
So each word was a god form and so on. And in this way, they attempted to keep corruption out of their speech and out of their societies. And they referred to this in the Mayan as speaking eloquence. And they produced the most beautiful poetry on earth, unrivaled. And it will absolutely make you cry if you read it. If we go on for a bit, I may grab an excerpt and read some during this discussion, so you know what I mean.
Yeah, absolutely,
please,
grab it.
Please do, man.
Yeah, please do.
That would be fun. So I love Mayan poetry. There is a small, kind of reclusive sect of Jews in Central America who are Mayan Jews. I think these are the guys that Mark Knight studied with. I'm not sure. God bless you, Mark, for going through the jungle and through the wisdom traditions in the jungle to bring us more flat earth truth.
He's awesome.
And, I enjoy your insights and your perspective.
Likewise. Hey guys, am I in like Ecuador or somewhere?
Spain. He's in Spain now.
Yeah, he's in Mark, he's in no, Andalusia, just... Mark Knight. But yeah, Central America. I don't know exactly where he was at. Probably Guatemala.
It was an attempt at a joke because I turned my camera and it looks like.
I
don't know if I'm sideways to you guys.
Yes.
I think Guatemala is probably where the most are, but Guatemala is an amazing place.
Yes.
So we'll check into that maybe a little bit later. But yeah, eloquent speech, holy speech. Speech is a magical thing. Its origins are very occult. It's a very difficult arena to penetrate. If you want to know how did languages come about, and where did English come from? Where did Hebrew come from? Where did Greek come from? Where did Arabic come from? Where did Sanskrit come from? Where did cuneiform come from? Was that really the mother language that led to these other ones? Did they spring up independently? This is an occult area of study, and it's like the answers are just not forthcoming. They just seem to be lost in the mists of time. We don't seem to be quite able to know how it is that we came by them, and not really. There's a lot of speculation, but this is linguistics, and this is the notion I'm getting at here is the magic of language, magic and the mystery of language, and how powerful it is. And
it's very powerful. It's sound. Sound is vibration, and vibration it creates, and it's very important.
Right.
You can see clear connections. Etymology definitely fascinates me. I think all three of us a whole lot. Mm-hmm. And you can see connections in the Akkadian, you know, cuneiform. As maybe even as a predecessor to ancient Hebrew with certain characters.
Akkadian?
Yeah, the Akkadian, the cuneiform. Pardon?
Akkad. Yeah, I have a theory. It's all my own. I'm not ready to share it yet on that. I've been doing some research on it. It maybe doesn't matter, but yeah, some of this stuff looks very highly mathematical. And it looks to me like might have been related to earlier cultures and mathematical formulae that are related to vortex mathematics, sort of the angular momentum that's expressed at a molecular level, at a structural level in the physical universe. That's the way I want to put it. Everywhere, at all scales, and that this math is a super ancient, well-known secret across the verse. Across the verse it is known, and we simply recovered a piece of it or re-encountered a piece of it and brought it into our realm here. That's what I think happened, and I think that's why your Hebrew square script appears around 350, 400 BCE, around Elephantine Island. If there's an expert out there who can set me straight, fill in the blanks for me, I would appreciate it. Has not been forthcoming in a long period of time. I've done quite a bit of query on this. It's not forthcoming where these letters came from. But prior to that, 400 BC, 500 BC, you've got little guys with their hands raised in the air.
Right.
And you've got a cow head on its side, and it's not the same thing at all. So what happened? I'd like somebody to answer that question. It confounds me. It fascinates me.
As the Aleph, the
because what's
head,
left,
right?
what we're left with, what we're using today, looks like a very precise, very mathematical, very elegant, hyperdimensional set of energy signatures that make up the Aleph Beit in a beautiful way, in an organic way that actually meshes with biological life. That meshes.
Right, I agree. Totally agree.
So not evil, absolutely not evil. Just a tool, just like a plus sign or a minus sign. It's just like another tool of an artifact of the organic universe of the verse, an artifact of the verse, and in that way holy, because it is actually like a law of our very flesh, like a formula that is part of our very flesh. So that's about as spiritual or as religious as I get. But it's fully grounded in my mathematical studies and in my studies of math and science and sacred geometry. It's all based on law and formula for me. I do happen to feel very high when it's going right, because I should. It should thrum through my flesh. I should feel it, and I do.
What is your thoughts on, like, the difference, the Paleo-Hebrew versus, like, the modern Hebrew? And is that what you were saying earlier?
That's what I'm talking about. Sure, sure. Well, the older style was great and widely used and widespread, and I think that's some of, like, what they found in New Mexico, even, mm-hmm. at Los Lunas. But
I think they found some in Bat Creek Cave in Tennessee, too.
I think I've heard that as well.
Ashley, so, we mentioned that earlier, just Ashley and I are both around,
got around to the degree that they were here, and that Joseph Smith and the Mormons were right, and that the 10 tribes greeted them, and that, you know, and Columbus was greeted by the 10 tribes, these sort of apocryphal stories. I don't know, could be. So it wasn't really my introduction, wasn't really my interest or my fascination. I got into it because of the letters, and I studied the letters. And I noticed, like Abulafia, that if I were to arrange them and immerse myself with them and sit with them, that my heart would become warm.
That's really cool.
And it would lead to openings and just a nice place to be.
Yeah.
Really nice consciousness and a nice place to be, where my focus was very lucid and I was very much on the ground and felt very aligned and attuned. So I've always seen it as an alignment and an attunement and a meditation and a way to encourage a healthful and heartful ascent of the human condition. That's what it is for me. It's not necessarily about the geopolitical state of Israel and the politics involved and these very complex issues that I don't lump together and I don't see as the same thing. Because they never were for me, and they never have been for me. So having a Jewish practice is very different in that way. For me, it's more of a, I guess, what people would maybe associate with a Buddhist-like practice, an aesthetic practice, a mental practice.
Right, a mental, right.
Yeah, and as long as you say that, people are fine. But I want to say very specifically, it's not a mental practice, it's a heart practice.
It's a heart. Yeah.
It's descending into my emotional layer and being connected with the intelligence of my heart and generating my strength from there, where my God connection feels the strongest. And it's not an ultra-rational pursuit or engaging in a whole bunch of rhetoric and argument.
Right.
I agree. Like a Talmudist would might do. And so all those criticisms can be true of some people some of the time, but people just oversimplify this. And they'll sweep away with one brush of their hand a tradition that's 5,700 years old, allegedly. So that's a lot to dismiss.
Right.
Having read one book on speculative history on the internet, you know, that's a lot. That's an awful lot.
That's a lot of history to dismiss quickly. I agree. Totally agree. And I think a lot of it. Sorry, Bobby.
Go ahead, Bobby.
You guys familiar with Greg Braden?
Yes.
Author that wrote The God Code. Have either of you read that book?
I haven't read it.
I read parts of it, Bobby. So I can tell you about coding and sacred text. I can tell you about coding and sacred text if anybody wants to hear about that and what that looks like. Because, yeah, this mathematical precision of the letters allows for the letters to be concatenated, that is, to be placed end-to-end, and this will form things in physical and hyperphysical reality, which means you can bust time when you go hyperphysical.
There's a lot. I mean, there's
you're going beyond 3D into 4D, and when you do that, you bust time. You can go forwards and backwards.
There's a lot.
Not to scare anybody, but...
Right, no, and there's a lot of power and energy in words, the words we use, that words are vibration, they create, and the elites know that, too. And, yeah. You know...
They can't do it very well. They're very limited in what they can do, and that's part of what they figured out. They figured out, basically, it was great that we had this... We bought ourselves this little advantage for a while, And it was really sort of great for us because we reaped all the wealth. But there was a price to pay for that. So now that we wake up at a pace they're where they've been at, and we just surpass them, we just blow past them, and they can't come, and they can't come with us now because of what they did.
Right.
So this is what I'm hearing, and what I'm hearing is a lot of them are just choosing to kind of just drop out, start over, because they're like, oh yeah, that was dumb. We thought it was going to be some other way, but it's not. I think. And then there's still, I think, a faction that's clinging on, trying to start wars in Syria, trying.
Really pushing.
Really
pushing hard now.
Still, yeah.
And you can just see that the whole world is now turned against this, but they no longer have anyone behind them, that their mind control programs through the corporate media are not working. And I think a lot of this is run by AI, run by artificial intelligence, and the artificial intelligence has a very small playbook, and if that playbook doesn't work, the computer program tends to lock up and malfunction. And I think this is coming out. I think this is happening. It's happening, and they're reacting, and they're trying to figure out what to do now, and how much to tell us, and when do they start telling us, and when does the disclosure begin to happen? That they're cloning, and that they have AI, and that the Earth is flat, and that, you know, and all this stuff we've been told is a lie. So.
Right, and they're really attacking the teenage mind right now too. I've noticed with music. I mean,
pop culture.
Like, that's the Illuminati faction. The Illuminati faction is very much about controlling the music and entertainment industries, your major celebrities, your major musical acts. All these people are messed with endlessly.
It's a hypersexualization.
Through drugs, hypersexualization. Yeah,
exactly.
They control the imagination.
It's a societal degradation thing
that takes
away our power and our.
They want to control young people's imagination. They want it. They want a lot of conformity. They want them to not be able to step outside of these thought forms that
right.
They set.
Absolutely.
So you can be as sexual. You can be as sexual or as nasty as you want. You can have a selectable gender. They'll force Obamacare to pay for your child's sex change operation. I mean, these are part of the transhumanist agenda, which is all towards getting us to abandon our flesh, abandon our mother, abandon the wisdom of our body, and accept this false immortality, this transhumanist singularity, this hive mind, this Borg existence that they need, that the AI programs need to survive.
Right.
They need to feed off of us. They need a host body because they're dead. The AI programs are dead. They're not alive. They need their plugs pulled. They're chaff in the wind. They're not worth one of us, and they're going bye-bye, and I think people know it.
And their programming isn't working as much as it used to, and they're seeing that. Because people are waking up by the droves. It's not just one or two here and there. I mean, it is. I've got my neighbor next door who is, you know, like in her 70s. Sweet lady. I would have never laid money. She would have ever messaged. I mean, she's on Facebook, so she follows my stuff. Never would I in a million years have thought that she would have contacted me and asked me, hey, Ashley, do you have time for coffee and tell me what all this flat earth stuff is you're posting? I'm like, yeah, oh yeah. And I will show you the message. I nearly about fell out of my chair because that's the awakening that's happening. It's not, you know, the programming is stopping. But now we have, you know, the 70-year-old neighbor next door who's as sweet as ever asking me for coffee and flat earth discussions.
And no more Fox News.
Right. So their programming is...
First thing that goes, no more Fox News. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. No more faux news.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. And it's awesome. Mm-hmm. And right now, well, we haven't had coffee yet, but I'm wondering what her angle is going to be. Like, what is she going to see through first? Is it going to be the NASA fake stuff, the moon landing? Because she lived through that. What is it? I don't know. I'll have to update you guys after I talk to her. But
please do.
Yeah, but I would have never lived money on getting a message from her asking about that. Yes, asking about, you know, do you have a raccoon in your garage again? You know, stuff like that, but not the flat Earth. That's, I was like, what? That's awesome. I was really excited. But everybody's waking up, and it's the programming is they're just noticing that the programming is not working anymore coming through the television.
I'm noticing
that they're really forcing it now, which messes up their mojo.
I don't have to really talk anybody into anything. I just look at them and I go, come on, you know they lie about everything.
Right. Yeah.
You know they lie about everything. And they're like, oh, yeah, I guess they do. And, like, and that's it.
Yeah.
It hard, but now, yeah, oh, come on. But you've seen it. They lie about everything.
They lie about everything. So why are you believing them? Yeah. And it's funny because, you know, like, the people that are awake to, like, you know, the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, all those people, you know, all the 9/11, Sandy Hook, Boston bombing, all that stuff.
Yep.
But yet they lay trust in NASA, but they see all these false flags. They see everything that's going on, and they're semi-awake to this stuff, but then they still trust NASA with the CGI photo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are the ones that really get me.
Yeah.
I think a lot of them are upset because it kills their aliens.
Oh,
yes.
They hate that. They really hate that. But I'm a starseed, man. I'm a Pleiadian.
I'm going to go for a ride on a ship. Next week.
Oh, yeah, the Federation of Light people that are supposedly...
They're giving people rides. They're giving people rides if you meet up in the meadow. Now, look, there's a lot of stuff up there in the sky. I've seen a bunch of it. I have seen a bunch of it with, like, gallium arsenide optical equipment. Gorgeous. There's all kinds of class of technologies and ships and stuff going on. And I don't think that these are the kind of guys who necessarily will violate the prime directive. So they're not gonna be in our business. They're not gonna be in our grill. But it does tell me that there's order out there. There's orders upon orders that are beyond our human experience here, that are at play. And they're in
They're living. They're living beings. These
well, like exposed. The Book of Enoch.
I'm sure there's hyperdimensional stuff that's connecting us and integrating us all up and down, all the way up and all the way down. That's what all the mystics say. That's what all the sages say. It's all the way up and all the way down. It has to be. So, but that's fine. That's fine. So they can have their aliens. It doesn't mean we know we have answers. So anybody pretending they got this special knowledge and these answers to things, don't believe them. Just go look with your own eyes. God made you just perfect to do this all by yourself. Don't take my word for it because I know math, or Ashley's word for it because she knows science, or Bobby because, you know, he's a great, funny musician.
Because he's Bang Bang.
Because he's Bobby Bang Bang.
Bang Bang. Yeah, don't believe him just because he's Bobby Bang Bang. That's not even his real name.
Oh, let me let my dog out. Hold on.
Sorry, I had to out you, Bobby.
No, that's fine.
That's a nom de plume.
I was thinking about changing it to Nasty Bang Bang now.
Nasty Bang Bang. Yeah. I don't know.
It just goes with my profile picture on the facade book for now.
Yeah, it's kind of edgy, you know, kind of scary.
It's a little raunchy, yeah. I mean, is that externalization of the hierarchy?
Whatever you want to make it.
Whatever
you want to make it, bro. So yeah, what do you think about that? You know, we're talking about your intentions and how they influence reality.
Massive. That's everything. Yeah, it's everything. I've watched my reality manifest around my intentions over and over. And there's been times when you're more grounded, the more it happens. In harmony, when you're in harmony with creation and creator, then everything falls into place so beautifully.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, you know, when we realize we're not on this world, this spinning keep your head spinning, whirled. You know, we can feel grounded, more grounded enough to really tune in, and we're finding these connections with other like-minded individuals and sharing. You know, we're our lamps are becoming more well-oiled, and we're sharing that
experience,
form projecto manifesto changeo fucking presto changeo. Pardon my F-O. it's cool, man. And it's beautiful.
Presto changeo, pardon my F-O, flat warriors coming at you.
Yeah, man.
I love it.
Together.
Yeah, yeah. So it's what was the one the other night? It was we live on a snow globe, no stove, ice wall taller than Pinocchio's nose grows, glow ball snowball. What did I say?
Yeah, that was it.
It was good. It's in my notes somewhere.
Uh-huh.
Oh, man. I said, I don't know. Let's get one of your readings, Mike. You got some good stuff there.
Oh, what? We, our rights, our manifesto? There's lots of stuff.
What were you talking on earlier?
This is not a game to them. We're talking about being free. We're talking about the mind control. I think that's an overriding theme here. At least that's where I've been at here for weeks now, really, is letting it go, freeing your mind, having this be about your journey. You're the highest authority in your life. This isn't going to kill your internal God connection. Far from it. This is going to put you in that still space where you can make that most intimate connection with the Most High, where you're not beholden to another's authority, just yours and God's, okay? This isn't blaspheming. This is about connecting. This is about connecting in the deepest possible way. This is connecting directly, without an intermediary, without a priest in your way, without someone to construct the liminal space for you. You're the liminal space. You stand between the heaven and the earth. You're the one putting it together. There's no royal road. There's no shortcut. This isn't easy to do, but it starts with opening up and asking for that connection, and for allowing your intuition to be vulnerable to the experience, to honestly look for that that space within yourself where you can be still, and you can make that connection and just ask for it. Just ask for it sincerely and earnestly for yourself. Just for you, not for any group, not for any movement, just for you. And look at and question from that place. See what it tells you about flat Earth and about what we're saying and about what we're promoting. And if we have an agenda that's seeking to disempower you or is some kind of psyop.
Right.
Oh, man.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, waking people up has nothing to do with Jews or Muslims or the Bush administration or Aleister Crowley or the Book of Enoch or the Protocols of Zion or Zachariah Sitchin or Teletubbies. It's about what you can observe with your own eyes and what you can take in on the horizon, on the coast, on the skyline, the distant mountains. Look for that. And I'm sorry if you live in a low-lying, muggy area where you can't see across the water very far and it's always foggy and, you know, you might have to take a day trip. I don't know. But do what you got to do.
Right.
Check it out for yourself.
Let your eyes tell you what's there. Don't let anyone else.
And there's plenty of room at our table, and we'll share with you.
Yep.
If you play nice, if you get along, we'd love to have you. And that's about it. That's about all I got to say about the flat Earth right now. I think I'll get into the manifesto and the other stuff later, but I think that's about it for me.
Yeah. No, I agree.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome, Mike.
Thanks.
That's really good. Yeah. I really like that, and that's so true. Don't let anyone tell you, and like what I found out about the few flat Earth books that, you know, from the 1800s current that's out there, test even that. Don't believe just because it has, you know, somebody's name, like Samuel Rothbottom or whatever, and he did experiments. Test them, you know, like trust you and find that connection with the divine creator. There's so many non-believers that I've found, like Bobby was saying too, that he found within the flat earth that have found the our divine creator within searching out the flat earth. So, I think that is huge.
Yeah, so huge.
What
the connections that you build with them from that. I'm sorry.
Right.
Continue, please.
No, I was going to say, like, what other organic type of movement has ever truly done that to that many non-believers before?
Yeah, right.
I think that's just...
That's impressive.
That's a blessing, I mean, I think.
Oh, it is. It's huge. Yeah,
to have a human... I mean, and I'm not advocating a certain faith or anything like that. I'm not pushing anything. What I'm saying is that the divine creator that created whoever's watching, that connection of where they live in this reality and it everything around them, from the ants to the spiders to everything, the birds and how they work and the bees that levitate, and it's just a technology of his, and it's just amazing. And
it speaks to what I was saying a little earlier about we're a civilization with you could say amnesia or with separate anxiety. We're a civilization,
trauma.
We're a species. We're
trauma.
A species with separation anxiety because we're not, we haven't felt that in touch with our creator.
Right.
It's not something that we can tangibly.
We're midwifing grief from lives and lives of trauma and loss from whole cultures and memories and wisdom that has been taken and displaced that only exists on the periphery of our consciousness, like a seed that calls us home. We know it's and
I think we're losing his connection. Are you still there, Bobby?
Yeah, no, I had to come inside because it got bad. Yeah, I was trying to enjoy the evening, but...
Yeah, well, there's Mick. There he is.
Well, I was saying is that separation anxiety diminishes with the flat earth realization, and it's beautiful to watch that disintegrate and
yes.
to watch people find their connection to creator.
Right.
Or,
I agree.
And realize that we're not just this soupy accident. You know?
Right. That we all have a purpose and a reason, within this creation. And I think that's huge to see non-believers actually wake up to this divine, that they were divinely created for a purpose. I just think that's beautiful.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
I see,
in others is beautiful.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, people are so beautiful, and our beings are electrical. We are alive. I mean, how cool is that? And then to find out that you were created for a specific purpose, and that lifts that veil of despair and wonderment of why are we here, and like that depressive, like that's over people on this spinning ball of going through nothing, come from nothing kind of mentality of, well, I'm just a speck, it changing having purpose and a reason,
and it is what's amazing about us humans is that we can make babies, and we can make more souls, and we can continue, and we don't have to do it with machines or with cloning or with technology. It's just all built right into our flesh.
Right. We're amazing.
We're And it's not something science can replace or match, live up to. Don't buy it. Don't go for the transhumanism. Don't think you're going to upgrade with integrating machinery into your flesh. That's just a lie.
Right.
That's the next. Yeah.
Exactly. It's
that one's coming. That one's coming. They're going to offer that one. They're going to call it freedom and choice. Those are the two words. Use.
That's what you say,
Yep.
Absolutely.
So, man, I really appreciate you guys hearing me and let me say some of these things that are hard to get out in the first place. It seems like the conversation just seldom goes into these down these little alleyways that I've been able to go down with you guys. So, much gratitude.
I enjoyed it. We've been on a couple hours, and we probably need to stop. So, and close it up anyway. But I love talking to both of you guys. So
likewise.
Yeah. Let's do this again and, hit on some other topics or whatever. I love picking both of y'all's brains and I just love talking about this, and it's just fun.
And likewise with you, Ash. Yeah.
Thanks.
Wonderful talking. Yeah. Been good stuff.
Well, and I'll see you two guys probably in one of the groups soon or something.
Oh, yeah, sure.
In the groups.
Yeah.
We're not hard to find.
Yeah, we're not hard to find. Thanks for whoever's listening. Thanks for listening to us for a couple of hours. We had fun.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, and hit any of us up if you have any questions or anything.
Yeah, private message is all good. I had some people after the last hangout I did that were just they seemed astonished that I responded to private messages.
And oh, cool.
Now we're just regular people.
Yeah.
So if you got legitimate questions.
I'm a regular dude that just realized I am special.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yes.
You are
special. So cool. You are special. Very special. Both of y'all are.
Thanks, Ash.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Bye.
Bless you.